Hey everybody, welcome back. Last week we were started our unit on subject matter. Subject matter is what your picture is about. For example, if you are drawing a picture of outside, what do you call pictures about outside? Yeah, we call those landscapes. What do you call pictures of people? We call pictures of people portraits. And what do you call pictures of objects that are sitting on a table? If an artist comes in and arranges all of these objects, place them on a table, and then decides to draw them or photograph them, what do we call paintings and drawings or photographs of objects that sit on a table? They give you a hint. They sit very, very, very still. Yeah, we call them still lifes. So my plan is the month of October, even though I might be, we're doing things a little different this week, I wanted you to leave for the whole month of October. I wanted you to have a work of art of each. So if our schedule works out well, I'm hoping everybody creates a landscape. So last week, we were thinking about things that you only see in the fall. And so some of my students were drawing fall landscapes like, pumpkin patches, how to draw a fall tree versus a summer tree, maybe a house, and, how do you make them look sort of old. So we can sort of check that off our list. And if you're an older student, some of my second and third graders were creating fall landscapes of tractor hay rides. And so we followed the Art Hub for Kids to create images that, again, we only see in the fall. So this week, what I'd like to do is let's focus on portraits. And I have a unique way that I'd like for us to tackle this art project is to not only draw portraits, which is usually pictures of people, but they could also be portraits of animals. And I got to thinking about maybe some of the creatures you might see in movies. Some of these made-up creatures, and or if you're reading a book like Where the Wild Things Are, the characters you see by Marie Sendak, the author and illustrator of Where the Wild Things Are, comes up with these really weird and strange-looking creatures. So my thought was, instead of just drawing a portrait of ourselves, which we would call that a self-portrait, or instead of drawing a picture of a person or someone else, I thought, with the spirit of October and everybody in sort of the fall theme, what if we develop a creature? What if we made a portrait of a make-believe creature and you get to develop this on your own? So let me show you some tricks of how authors and illustrators who are drawing these characters for books and artists who are developing these creatures for movies like Star Wars, Harry Potter movies, you see a lot of strange creatures in both of those movies. So let me show you their techniques and let me teach you the skill of how we do creature development, and let's draw a portrait. So what I'd like for you to do is I'm going to flip the camera around so you actually, and let me talk you through the steps. Watch me go through the creature development process, see what I draw, and say, you know what, I think I'm going to add that for my portrait, or I like that idea, or I like that technique. And then when I'm done, we can turn the lights back on, and then you'll have your chance to draw and develop your creature and a portrait of your creature. So give me a second, I'm gonna flip the camera around. All right, everyone, let me explain the, before I go into creature development and show you the process, let me show you some characters first. For example, let's look at Where the Wild Things Are, and the author and the illustrator is Marie Sendak. And if we look at Mr. Sendak's characters, for example, like Max. Max is, he's a boy, but he's wearing a wolf costume. But if we were going to draw a portrait of Max, I would have to draw a boy's nose, a boy's eyes, a boy's mouth. But I'd give him ears like a wolf. I'd give him a tail like a wolf. I'd give him paws and claws like a wolf. So creature development is basically where we take parts of one animal, parts of another animal, we merge them together and make a new creature, just like Max. When Max is sent to his room and he an ocean comes in and a jungle grows and he sails off to where the wild things are, he's met, when he reaches to the island, he's met by a couple of wild things. And if you look at these creatures, the main wild thing, it looks like a lion. It's got a lion's tail. He's got a lion's body with paws and claws. But he's got a human nose. It's got human hair, like Mona Lisa would have. He's got a horn on the nose, like a rhinoceros, and horns on its head, like a bull. So we could say this is made of human parts, lion parts, bull parts, and a rhinoceros. So all of these different animals merge together to make one. Looking at all of the other wild things doing the wild rhombus, you see the first character, which is one of my favorites, is part cat. It's got orange and yellow stripes. He's got a beard and hair like a person would have and a nose. He's got horns like a bull, but he's got legs like a dragon or an alligator, and he's got a wolf's tail, just like Max. This character, I'm not really sure what the body, sort of looks like a monkey or an orangutan. He's got a little tail like a duck would have. He's got duck feet, but he's got a human nose and human hair. This one looks like a bear's body, but it's got human feet and toes, but it's got a bull's head. And so all of these creatures are made not of just one animal. They're made of different kinds of animals put together to make a new creature. Meet Terryl Witlatch. Miss Witlatch is an artist who just loves animals. Everything from seahorses to moose to caribou to baboons and everything else in between. And so I actually got to meet Miss Witlatch and found out that she makes characters. She makes up these really neat characters for some really big movies like Star Wars and some other movies like that would have really neat creatures as they travel from planet to planet. So I asked her when I met her, I said, what are you sketching in your sketchbook? And she was nice enough to actually let me look in her sketchbook and take a few photographs. And so this is based off of a rhinoceros, but Miss Witlatch loves dinosaurs. And so she gave this rhinoceros a big, ginormous dinosaur tail and a huge spike instead of a small horn. She gave it a really big horn. When I turned the page of her book, I noticed that she was working on a hippo. But this hippo, she put on snail antennas. And so what if we take an animal that's really, really, really tiny, like a snail, and put it on a big animal like a hippo? You know, what kind of new creature can we create? Let's give it a dinosaur tail with some really cool feathers on the end. Yeah, I don't know what kind of purpose that may serve. Maybe it swats flies really easily in the summertime, or use it as a fan to cool off, or maybe just as a decorative item and just looks really nice. This is another creature that she has created. And we see the main animal as a horse. But let's give it a dinosaur tail. Instead of giving it a mane of hair, let's put a fish fin on the back as a mane. And instead of giving it hooves, why don't we put ostrich feet? Ostriches run really fast. What if we combine that with another animal that runs fast, like a horse? I wonder how fast this horse will actually run. Instead of giving it fur or hair, what if we give it really nice, sleek skin? So it sort of makes me wonder if this horse creature could actually swim underwater. She studies animals like horses from the skeletal system to the muscular system to the epidermis, which is dealing with the outer covering of the animal. You know, does it have skin? Does it have hair? Does it have scales? You know, what kind of climate does this animal live in? And she takes all that into consideration as she creates these creatures, and then she creates the world around them, the habitat where they live, for all of these movies and things. So she actually creates some of the background as well. You might not recognize Miss Witlatch's name, but I know you guys, if you've seen Star Wars, you've seen some of her work. She actually came up with the Jar Jar Binks character. And if you look at the top, since he's got eyes on the top of his head, and looking at his snout, it sort of reminds me of a duck, but it also reminds me of a hippo. And so I think she used many different creatures and made it stand and walk like a person. But if you look at the skin, you know, it's very aquatic. It loves the water. Now, doing an opposite character, she also designed this character who races the pod racers in the desert. And so I got to looking carefully. The head reminds me a lot of a camel. And that's another desert animal. But what if we change it instead of being really big? This creature has to be small to fit in those pod racers. Now, let's look at movies. We've seen illustrators for books coming up with new creatures using creature development techniques. We've seen Ms. Witlatch, who is a creature developer for big movies like Star Wars and Harry Potter's another good movie if you want to see some interesting made-up creatures. But let's look at Monsters Incorporated. Animators also follow this creature development process. So when you look at Sullivan, he looks like a bear, but he's got a dinosaur tail, but it's hairy. He's got horns like a ram, which is a goat, hands like a human, but he's got these really big claws. And Mike, he doesn't have any hair at all. He has two little tiny horns. He doesn't have two eyes. He only has one. He's got feet like a large bird would have, like an ostrich, but he got human hands. And then Mike's love interest in the movie, she's got snake for hair. And I tell you, these animators really spend a lot of detail and in putting a lot of work into all these tiny details like the texture of her hair. They draw every little scale for each of these snakes that she has for hair. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to show you one that was so scary. But Boo is the little girl's name who gets lost in the monster world. And they had to give her a disguise. And so they made her into a creature as well. And I like how they used tentacles as part of her costume instead of using arms. In the second movie, Monsters Incorporated, you have all these really strange creatures. And so creature developers, they're handed the task of creating things that nobody had seen before. And you just use your imagination. So you got a character here who doesn't have one head, has two. But instead of having two eyes, it only has one on each. Instead of having two arms, it has four. Instead of having legs and feet, it's got tentacles. And here's one, I like the texture of this, the tentacles and the color. And this character has no hair, it's just really thick skin, like a rhino. And this guy is very similar to an octopus because he's got suction cups. And he sticks to everything. And this cool creature, whose name is Art, which is, I thought that was sort of funny, is nothing but legs, hair, and mouth. And then in the movie, they had to sort of pull together what they all had, what they were really good at. Because, you know, they might not be good at a lot of things, but when they all worked together, they found out that, you know, they could do amazing things. So it's time now for me to show you how to actually go through the creature development process. So I'm going to change gears and I'm going to show you some of my tricks on how to create a really cool creature. And then it's going to be your turn. Hello, everyone. What I'm trying to do is I want to talk you through the steps and stages or the process of doing a creature development. So first, let's start off with the eyes of our creature. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw some different eyes, and then you can maybe sort of pick and choose which eyes you like. So for example, if I wanted to draw a creature that is surprised, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw two really large circles and then maybe a little black dot in the center. So if I came up and sort of accidentally scared my creature, then it's going to have eyes like that. Now, after I scare my creature, it may turn from being surprised And if I do a capital D that fell over, so can you sort of see how that looks like a capital D? If it fell over, if I angled the diagonals inward and then put a little black dot at the top, then you might say that creature might be what? Yeah, it's a little angry. Okay, so that's my angry creature. But if I take my fingers and I push the D's down, then it might change. So if I draw them this direction, flat, flat, and then a smile, smile, then it's like my creature going, really? Did you just really scare me? Really? Or if I try to change the subject and started tickling the monster, then I might have these happy eyes that curve up, curve up, and then if you're smiling really big, your smile pushes your cheeks up into your eyes, and you have these the curved bottom of your eye, and then we could put that black dot on that. So maybe I told the creature a joke, or tickled it, and then it's smiling really big. Another a set of eyes I could draw. It could be what we call sort of sleepy. So if we accidentally wake up the creature, it hadn't quite woke up all of the way. So I draw two circles, and then I draw this heavy eyelid sort of toward the bottom. And I do a little slight curve to show that the eye is round. And then I'm going to do a little black dot on the bottom of them. And it looks like my creature's eyes are very, very sleepy. Now, there's many, many more eyes that you could draw, but these are some of the ones that I thought we might could at least start with. So we can call this these are some choices for your eyes. Okay, so we're going to scoot that over to the side for a second. So now let's sort of talk noses. Okay, so let me get a new sheet. So if you're going to draw noses, you know, we think about all the different kinds of creatures and animals. So let's first start with a human nose. So if I was drawing Max or another character or myself, if you look at yourself when you get home in the mirror or look at your parents, you know, usually we have like a little circle or ball at the end of our nose. And then we have these little, what I call parentheses on both sides. And then we have the little bridge that comes from the point of our nose up to our brow right between our eyes. So that could be a human nose. Now, if I'm going to do a dog nose, there's a couple of ways to do a dog nose. A realistic dog nose is going to have sort of a flat at the top. And then it's going to come down and go back up and then back down again a little bit longer and then back up and then down again and back up. So you do this really weird wave. And then from the point of that, you sort of curve up and it's like 2 U's. It's a dog's nose. Now to do sort of a different kind of dog nose or sort of a cartoony dog nose, again, it's that curve across the top, and it's sort of like a U or almost like a V, and then it's a little easier to draw. So, you know, you can do either one. A cat's nose is more triangular. So if I make a triangle that's upside down, and it's funny how just drawing it just a little different, a little bit more of a curve or a little bit of a point, changes from a dog to a cat. And of course, you can always put the whiskers on. You know, it could be really, really whiskery. And there's your cat. A pig's nose. So I'm trying to think of all, different kinds of animals that you might be interested in. And it's got two ovals, vertical ovals in the middle. That could be a pig's nose. A bird's beak is a little different. So if I make a sort of curve like we did for this, but a little bit more curve and a little bit bigger, and then make the letter V, looks like a piece of pizza or pie, but that's actually your bird beak, looking at it from head on. We call that a frontal view. And then, of course, birds do have noses and nostrils, but their nostrils are at the sort of the base of their beak, closer to the head. This could also be sort of like a mouse if you make it smaller. Just trying to think of different animal noses or snouts that we might pick and choose from as we're creating our creature. And I'm just trying to give examples. And so this could be our noses. So we got eyes, and then we got noses. Real quickly, scoot that off to the side. Let's think about ears. There's lots of animals, but different kinds of ears. So if I just draw a sort of a curved line to represent the top of the head, if I do these C's and come back like this, whose ears would these be? Yeah, it could be a human ear. And, usually they have that little line in it, the little spot right there, a little line, a little hump. And those could be human ears. If I go a hump and then I make these fuzzy C's, then whose ears could these be? Yeah, it could be a bear. And if I do the same thing, but I don't make it furry, I can make it really large like this. It could be a couple of things. It could be like a monkey with large ears. I scooted up there. I'm sorry. Or it could be a mouse. And if I repeat that on the inside, that could look more like a mouse ears. Going with our dogs, cats, and other animals that we're more familiar with, if it's a dog with floppy ears, they may droop down. If you're doing a dog or a cat that has pointy ears up at the top, they're more triangular. We got mouse, we had humans, we got dogs, we got cats, we got bears. Elephants will have ginormous ears. Now I got to draw it small because I'm running out of room. But if I want to draw elephant ears, if you want to draw Horton like Dr. Seuss, it goes up and then back down, and then it's sort of wavy. Hey, I'm going to run out of room. I'm so sorry. So those could be elephant ears, and I'm so sorry I ran out of room on that. As soon as I get down, I'll think of somebody, another animal that has ears. But some animals, their ears are actually built inside of their head, like birds. Birds do have ears, but they're actually underneath their feathers, and they're more like holes in the side of their heads right behind their beaks that allows them to hear, because they're excellent hearers. So we have ears, we have noses, and we have eyes. So now let's put all of this together and show you the technique so that we can sort of piece it together. So again, and we'll have these examples. There's the ears, there's noses, and there's our eyes. But now let's sort of put this together. Okay, so I don't have enough room on my camera space or on my drawing table, so I'm going to scoot those off to the side. I can see them, and I'm going to leave them for you so that we can put them on the board so everybody else can see them. All right, so now here's my creature. Let me take all of these parts and merge it together to create a creature. If I was actually in the room with you, I would take suggestions from each table, and you guys can tell me what animal and what part, and then I'll merge all of these things together. And so I don't know what I'm drawing until you tell me, and then we don't know what the creature is until we're actually finished. So since I'm sort of doing this to demonstrate, so I'm going to be sort of picking parts. You can draw vertically, as where your paper's nice and tall, or you can draw horizontally. Maybe your animal walks on all fours, maybe it likes to crawl or run like a horse, then you can draw it vertically. It could go either way. I'm going to draw mine vertical. I'm sorry, that is horizontal in case I misspoke. Horizontal, I'm going to draw mine vertically. So again, first thing I'm going to do is I start with the eyes. What kind of eyes do I want to draw? So I sort of like The surprised eyes. You know, a lot of students will say, draw the angry eyes. I said, man, a lot of people are angry. But I'd like to draw some surprised eyes just for the fun of it, because I think it's sort of funny, especially the thought of sneaking up and scaring a creature. So here's my surprised eyes. So I'm going to give it a black dot. Now, you can draw, if you got a black marker, you can draw with the marker. A lot of times I'll draw with a black crayon. This project, if you're coloring with crayons, it's actually really cool, really good if you actually draw with the black crayon. Next, let's think about, I've got my eyes, and so now what kind of nose? Again, if you were with me, I'll have you guys to pick one. Do you want a human nose? You want a dog's nose? You want a cat's nose? You want to give it a beak? You want to give it a pig's nose? You want to give it a trunk like an elephant? You know, what kind of nose you want? So I sort of like the cartoony dog nose. So again, I'm just going to make a sort of a triangle upside down. It's sort of rounded. It's not as pointy as the cat's nose. And then I got to do the U. Okay. Now, next, I need you to tell me a shape. Give me a shape that we want to make the head. It could be a circle. It could be a square. It could be a triangle. It could be a hexagon. It could be any kind of shape that you want. So you, what you guys can do is just name me a shape. Okay. Hey, that's a good one. What if I did a triangle? Okay, so if I did a triangle, maybe the triangle is upside down. Now you can, again, use any kind of shape you want for the head. All right, next is ears. Somebody give me a name of an animal. It could be a human, it could be an animal, but give me some kind of ears. So, again, so reminds, I like the big buggy eyes. I think I'm going to go for bear ears. And so I might do some shaggy, like capital C's, but they're really, really shaggy. It's a curvy zigzag. There's my ears. Okay. Now, next, what kind of body does this animal have? So if I scoot it up, what kind of body does this animal have? You know, give me another animal. It could be anything from a fish. It could be a dragon. It could be, a dragon, sort of a make-believe creature. It could be any of things. So, and if you can't think of one, just come up with a shape. So what if I draw an oval shape? Okay, and that could be my body. Now, if I mentioned dragon earlier, I like dragons. So what if I give it a dragon body? Dragons have these scales on their bellies. And so what if I draw another U, or it's sort of like the oval, and I draw some lines on it? That could be like my dragon. Okay, now this animal is going to have arms. So what kind of arms do you want this creature to have? Again, think of all kinds of arms. It could be arms and hands like a human. It could be a horse that may have hooves. You may have an animal that, thinking about something that lives in the ocean or aquatic, maybe this creature has tentacles. So I might add these curvy arms, and tentacles usually have these suction cups on it. So I might give it some really cool suction cups. And so I'm going to try to repeat the other arm here. Give it. Now I'm doing these little suction cups on the side, sort of like little lumps. And then I can go back and maybe give it some more circles or ovals. Okay. So now what kind of legs are we going to give this creature? We've got tentacles for arms, and it could have more than just two. You know, you can have an octopus has eight, so you can make it as many as you want. And so now what kind of legs do we want for the bottom? You know, it's got bear ears. What if I gave it sort of bear legs? It's sort of a fuzzy little creature. And it's got like a big bear claw. Try to scoop my paper up so you can see the feet of this. And so I'm going to do this curved line for a bear. But, you know, what if this creature has more than just two legs? Maybe it's got three legs or maybe four legs. Your imagination is sort of your limit. So whatever you can think of. And, if you know, we can actually create stories about these creatures. Maybe it's got little toenails, little triangle toenails. You can always create these stories of about where these animals and creatures sort of live. Okay, now I got one more part of my animal. We got the head going. It could have horns. I didn't think about horns, but it could actually have horns. What if mine's got two little billy goat horns, but they're really, really tiny? Really tiny. Giraffes have horns on the top of their head, so maybe, and they're really short. But the last thing is, what kind of tail does it have? And I like Terryl Witlatch, the lady, the artist who created some of the characters from Star Wars. The next thing, I've got my everything drawn. Now I want to go in and add color and details to this character. So if this is a fuzzy creature, or especially around the head, you know, what kind of fur is it gonna have? This is sort of my creature that I made from scratch. You saw from beginning to end. And when you finish your creature, please develop the background. You know, the background, your landscape around it gives us feedback of what this character is. Where does it live? What kind of things it likes? What's the habitat like?